Good morning. I'm Raleigh Flynn, the president of the Foreign Policy Research Institute. Today, we're going to have a discussion with Jeremy Black, who is, I know many of you always come to his events because he's always entertaining as well as informative and educational. He's going to be talking about his new book, Military Strategy, A Global History. And I'm not sure what the count is now on the number of books he's written, well over 100, I think. And we're going to, the event's going to be moderated by our longtime senior fellow, Ron Granieri, who's a Templeton Fellow, as well as our executive director of FPRI's Center for the Study of America and the West. And this particular event is part of our new series, People, Politics, and Prose, which is hosted by Mr. Granieri. For those of you who don't know him, Ron's a specialist in contemporary German and international history with degrees from both Harvard and the University of Chicago. He's a recipient of a federal chancellor scholarship from the Alexander von Humboldt Foundation. He's a member of the American Council on Germany's Young Leader Program. He currently is an associate professor of history at the U.S. Army War College, and he's previously taught at the University of Pennsylvania, Temple University, Syracuse, Furman University, and the University of Tübingen. He's the author of The Ambivalent Alliance, Konrad Adenauer, the CDU, slant CSU, and the West, 1949-1966. He's currently completing a book entitled The Fall and Rise of German Christian Democracy from Détente to Reunification for the Oxford University Press. Thank you, Ron, for being with us today. Just a couple of notes. If you have questions, please put them in the Q&A box, not the chat. If you have questions for our speakers, put them in the Q&A box. If you put them in the chat, our moderator and speaker may not see them. The chat, use that. If you have a technical issue, we'll monitor it for that. But if you have a question for the speakers, for the discussion, in the Q&A box. So without further ado, I shall turn it over to Ron Granieri.
Thank you, Raleigh, and thanks everybody for joining us today. Good morning. Welcome to this latest episode of People, Politics, and Prose, FPRI's new program of conversations with authors about their works, their careers, and the ideas that drive them. I'm indeed Ron Granieri, and I'm delighted to be here with all of you and all of us at FPRI. Thank you for joining us on Zoom. Of all the terms that populate the discussion of international affairs, few have attracted the same amount of attention and the same accretion of cliche as strategy. It has been compared to three-legged stools, praised as the way to link ends, ways, and means, identified as the way to rescue choice from circumstance, and so on. Strategy is supposed to provide the why to help develop the practical how for any large-scale enterprise. Few can offer a clear definition, even as everybody affects to understand how important it is to think strategically. Chinese philosopher Sun Tzu admonishes us that, quote, strategy without tactics is the slowest route to victory. Tactics without strategy is the noise before defeat. And yet, scholars and practitioners still wrestle with the concept in the abstract, even as they criticize competing strategies. General Eisenhower famously once said, all plans are useless, but planning is essential. And that sentiment was shared by his wartime colleague, Winston Churchill, who flipped it around a little bit to remind us that however beautiful the strategy, you should occasionally look at the results. So considering the possible relationship between ideas and results, between strategy and the construction of ideas, to try to figure out how we can understand this best, we have with us, thankfully, Jeremy Black, whose new book, Military Strategy, Global History, which I have right here. Go ahead and hide that. Military Strategy, Global History from Yale University Press takes on the challenge of tracing the development of strategic thought across time and space. Is there a single universal definition of strategy? How do different cultural and temporal contexts shape our understandings of it? What is the relationship between theory and practice? These are but a few of the questions that Professor Black covers in his book and which we will discuss today. Longtime FPRI senior fellow Jeremy Black is emeritus professor of history at Exeter University. He studied at Queen's College, Cambridge, St. John's College, Oxford, and Merton College, Oxford, before joining the University of Durham as a lecturer in 1980. There he gained his PhD and ultimately his professorship in 1994. Prolific author of over 100 books on topics ranging from modern British history, the World Wars, the Holocaust, maps, and imperialism, to the politics of James Bond, Professor Black's work adds up to the most sustained presentation of British history in recent decades. The Society of Military History recognized Jeremy Black's work in April of 2008, presenting him with the Samuel Eliot Morrison Award for Lifetime Achievement, and we at FPRI have been delighted to have him as a senior fellow for quite some time now, and we are especially delighted to have him with us this morning. Greetings, Jeremy Black.
Greetings.
So, Jeremy, what do you think the general public needs to know most about strategy?
Well, I think you summed it up very clearly. There is no one definition. It's like many words. It has a variety of meanings. But what it captures is that we do need to think in terms of priority. I think strategy is ultimately about prioritization. You take this wide range of wish fulfillment and, you know, foreign policy, military affairs, businesses, your own personal life, you can throw all sorts of things to the fore. But strategy is the process by which you work out the priorities for yourself, your organization, your country, and linked to that, how best to fulfill them.
Mm-hmm. How well do you think terms like strategy and strategic are used these days in discussions of international affairs? It seems to me that the temptation whenever a learned practitioner of some sort is on television, right, whenever they want to criticize an ongoing policy, they will claim that somebody is not thinking strategically. And yet, how do you feel about the way that the term is used and abused in popular discussions?
Well, I think all of us are aware that language is being eroded in its precision. So, I mean, it's not just strategy. Take war. War, most of us would think, is an organized activity in which force is used to achieve a purpose and people are killed. That's what most of us would think war is about. But these days you will have war on waste, war on cancer. I mean, when America declared, I don't know if you remember this, America was at war before the war on terror. Do you remember who it was at war with?
I believe we were at war with poverty for quite some time.
You were at war with crime.
And with crime.
Planned war on crime. Now, what did that mean? Known drug dealers in Northeast Philadelphia being machine gunned? No, it didn't. I mean, you know, it was an absurdity. So strategy is exactly the same. And incidentally, you mentioned I've written a book on Holocaust. One of the things I find most distasteful is the way that the term Holocaust is now used indiscriminately by people to describe something they don't like. So one facile and stupid British politician recently referred to a Holocaust of hedgehogs. So in other words, a complete draining of the meaning from the term. So in the case of strategy, I think that the root cause of the word is, as it was first devised in modern usage, which was the late 18th century, to refer to war. But strategy has now been applied to all sorts of things. So in Lawrence Friedman's book, which is really all over the place, strategy means just about anything, how you might decide to go to a party and sort of try and, you know, elicit the sympathy of members of the opposite sex, shall we say. I think is that a Me Too way of putting things without getting into trouble? So the point is that nowadays strategy has become almost meaningless as a term. Now, my main interest is strategy as a military activity. I think that that is where it captures its essence into how states, the governments that run those states, how they determine in a world which is hostile, and strategy is usually based on the principle that there is hostility out there. So if you're talking about business strategy, it's based upon the notion that there is competition. Nobody's going to write a strategy on the basis that there's no competition for businesses. But going back to states, it's based on the idea idea that out there, there are other states, other players, other frictions, which are going to try and stop you doing what you think appropriate and are going to try and lessen your ability to act. Mm-hmm. So strategy is a question of how, in that context, you move forward. It's not simply about fighting, but it's about, in many states' senses, what I would call preparedness.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I guess that's the complicated question is, you know, at the War College, we talk a lot about the strategic level versus the operational level versus the tactical level. And the idea that the further back you are from the battlefield, once upon a time, I suppose tactics was anything you did in sight of the enemy and strategy was what you did to get within sight of the enemy. But when we think about how the terms are used or how we imagine this, is strategy directly connected to the issue of planning in terms of concrete planning? Or where does the relationship between sort of abstract thinking about goals, where does that fit in with your definition of strategy?
Well, I prefer, as you know, I've written several books on this topic, I prefer to focus on the strategic actions of strategic actors, mm-hmm. not the strategic thought of strategic thinkers. Right. So I'm not interested in what academics have to say about it, and I'm not much interested in Clausewitz worship, which I think has been pushed far too far by often academics because they like people who think in theoretical terms. Mm-hmm. What I'm concerned much more is the practicalities mm-hmm. of it. Mm-hmm. Now, part of it, and you said at the very beginning, and I agree with you entirely, it varies across the world. Now, not just the word, but the actual social and political context. So obviously, the strategic options for a state which is authoritarian and dictatorial, let us say North Korea today, is totally different to the strategic options for the United States. So it's not just a question of weapons systems and how one plans to develop weapon systems. It's part of a broader question of how you take forward the values of your society in order to fulfill its goals, assuming that it has a distinctive strategic culture, which in large part is to do with the question that we're talking, you know, this is an American organization, FPRI, we are talking about how the American strategic context is at the moment. So America at the moment is, for example, a society that doesn't have conscription. Mm-hmm. It is not a dictatorship. It knows that it every 4 years will have a major election and every 2 years a less major election, which may well affect the political context. It knows that it has a fiscal policy in which the state simply can't expropriate the possessions of its citizens in order to forward its goals. It has international interests, not just because it is concerned as the world's leading economy with interests, markets, and sources around the world, but also because it believes in a rules-based system. Now, all of those are key strategic parameters within which the United States operates, but part of the problem for the United States is other players are not operating within the same parameters. So you have a fundamental notion in my terms of strategy is what I call a strategy, asymmetry. Those are fundamental elements of the situation. And those are not easy to address. So that, for example, you might engage in a war in which you kill more of the opponents than they kill of yourself. Let us say the United States in Vietnam. You occupy most of the terrain, and yet it's not going your way because your domestic parameters aren't happy with the situation. And also, and another key thing for American policymakers and strategists, in the Vietnam War period, was of course America also had to consider the knock-on consequences for South Korea, in its American interests in the Middle East, in American interests in the NATO area. So America was having to think in broader strategic terms, mm-hmm. as well as the question of what specifically happens around Da Nang.
Well, and there are several different strands of what you just brought up that I want to address. So the first one, though, is, since if in your connection between the strategic thought of strategic practitioners, we get to the basic question of how do we separate a strategy from the results? To phrase it more bluntly, can you win with a bad strategy, or does winning automatically make that strategy good? Similarly, can you lose with a good strategy? If we think of strategy that once we're talking about practice, we end up talking about the collision between whatever plans you went into a struggle with and precisely what you mentioned, the strategy of your opponent, which might actually thwart you simply on the basis of coming from a completely different direction. So how should we analyze and evaluate strategies? If we only evaluate them based on the results, then what difference does it make what kind of thoughts people bring in before the results come out? So what is the relationship between planning and the results?
Yeah, those are good questions. Let's try and give some examples, because I think it often helps. You know, a lot of academics, they talk waffle, but they won't come up to examples.
And we'll say one of the beauties of your book is there are plenty of examples.
Okay, so let's try and take two with reference to the United States. Let's take the two, we'll start off with separatist wars, and then we'll look at the Vietnam War at the end. Now, two separatist wars to start with, and I'm not discussing at all the rights or wrongs of them. One, the War of American Independence, and two, the American Civil War. So they're both separatist wars. In each case, there's a fundamental asymmetry. All the Americans, the Patriots, have to do is to stop the British winning. All the South has to do is to stop the North winning. There is no need for the Patriots to conquer London. There is no need for the Southerners, the Confederates, to conquer New York, Boston, or Washington. Now, it is the realization of that you see in both cases. So in the case of the United States, or what becomes the United States, the Patriots, Washington, in a sense, having done badly in the early battle stages, you know, loses at Brandywine, loses at Long Island, etc., he switches very sensibly to what was called at the time, with reference back to the classics, a Fabian strategy. Now, on top of that, of course, they manage a great blow by a congruence with the French at Yorktown. But even if Yorktown hadn't been there, they've stopped the British winning, which ultimately means that the British have been thwarted. Now, if you look at the Civil War, there is an attempt to do the same. I mean, in essence, you might say the classic line is that the South could never have won because the North had many more resources. Philadelphia, for example, a great center of Northern recruitment and industrial strength of Pennsylvania. How on earth can the South win? Well, they certainly couldn't win if you assume they're going to conquer the North. But of course, what they're planning to do, what they're trying to do, is to marry their strategy to the politics of it. The North continues with elections. There are adversarial political parties there. The Democrats are less convinced of the value of the war, more willing to negotiate. And right up till the summer of 1864, Lincoln still thinks that he might lose. What is interesting about the Civil War is 6 months after the election, the war's over. It's not over because some dramatic military event, I mean, Grant has done well around Richmond, but the key thing is there is nothing anymore for the South to do. It can't do it anymore. Lincoln is back. The radical Republicans are in again. The pressure is going to go on. They can't cope with the pressure for another 4 years. Now take the Vietnam War. Mm-hmm. The Vietnam War is usually portrayed as a terrible American failure, which for those people who died and their families, it obviously was, you know, miserable. In fact, in broader strategic terms, America ends the 1970s in a far, far, far stronger position than America had begun the 1960s in East and South Asia. I mean, bluntly, once the nationalists who were inclining towards the communists in Indonesia had been toppled, which is, in other words, which was a combination of the CIA and various Indonesian generals, once that had happened, it didn't actually matter what happened in Vietnam after that. The West had got its strategic strategic depth. But then on top of that, the West got out of it because of the need Mao had in order to play off against the Soviets, and the need Nixon had in order to try and end the war. You end up with the American-Chinese rapprochement, which gives a degree of stability until the 2000s. Then in the 2000s, it goes pear-shaped because China and Russia get chummy again. And that is the fundamental flaw with the West's strategy. It's nothing, you know, obviously you can debate till the cows come home about Afghanistan and Iraq, but the key problem that hit us in the 2000s were closer relations between China and Russia. So if you're thinking in the broader strategic terms, that's what you're concerned about. And people hate you for it because you're actually prioritizing. You're saying that and strategy is about prioritizing. It's if you're an American policymaker, and it is saying, as you know, debates go on all the time. I've spoken at Carlisle, and we had a very interesting conference, off the record conference there some years before, which was essentially about prioritization. Now, you know as well as I do that in public politics, strategy is a very difficult thing to discuss, which is why it tends, when it's discussed in public politics, to be the second order thing of the weapons platforms you invest in, because everybody can have a view on that. But the key questions are, how are you going to reconcile potential clashes in different areas, and what are going to be most important? Now, there is no correct fixed answer to that.
This is actually a good place to raise a point that you brought up, but also to bring in a question from outside. But the point that you brought up, the idea that for the Southerners to believe that in the Civil War, that all they had to do was that they had to not lose, or that that the North had to not win, that of course Lee found himself placed under a great deal of political pressure to invade Pennsylvania, right? Not once, but twice. And certainly General Longstreet didn't think it was necessary to do that. And that led to friction at Gettysburg, and Gettysburg turned out exactly as badly as you would expect if an army is doing something it shouldn't be doing. But the issue of politics, it influenced Lee, because of course Jefferson Davis was not satisfied with a purely passive strategy. And similarly, the problem with Vietnam is that the United States was faced with the political problem of, one could argue that holding the line for as long as the United States did in South Vietnam allowed the fortification or the reinforcement or the stabilization of not only Indonesia, but of the Philippines, of South Korea, of Taiwan. And so in the long run, but that's precisely the problem, is the long run, is the relationship between politics and the long run. And Henrik Breitenbach, one of our listeners, brings up this question as well, the relationship between regime types and strategies. That, and this goes back to our point you have a chapter on Republican strategies and the problem of republics, is when we try to understand how strategy is made and how it is sold, how it is packaged, how it is received, is regime type the most important distinction between states, Republican regimes that have to deal with public opinion are simply in a different place when it comes to making strategy than a authoritarian regime that can ignore public opinion?
Yeah, authoritarian regimes can't necessarily ignore public opinion. I mean, you'll notice if you've read the Goebbels diary, Goebbels, for example, was really worried after the bombing of Hamburg about public opinion there. So I wouldn't say authoritarian regimes can ignore public opinion. Look at Saddam Hussein in 1991, having to suppress a large-scale Shia uprising in the south. In many senses, authoritarian regimes are more vulnerable to public opinion, because in a democratic regime, you can lance the tensions by changing the government. What I would say the major difference in terms of strategy are those states that most have to fear instability within and insurrection within, and where the prime target and the prime responsibility of the military is control within. And that is true of the majority of states. it is only a minority of states that take part in out-of-area wars. Mm-hmm. And as a result of that, most of the writing on strategy is complete drivel, because it doesn't tell you about what you need to know if you're running Paraguay or Madagascar. What it does is tell you what you need to know if you're running the United States, which is fine, because the United States is the most important power. But one of the difficulties is that if you project your power somewhere else, you have to be very wary of assuming they are going to have the same equations about success and failure that you're going to have. Now, sometimes it's to your advantage that you might be up against an authoritarian regime. Let me give you an example. One of the enormous weaknesses of let's say, Iraq under Hussein was precisely that you appoint the military because they are loyal to you, mm-hmm. and you promote them accordingly. And some of these people are competent, but many of them are not competent, or their competence is different. Their competence is a matter of political loyalty, and their competence is not therefore necessarily designed to be against a state-of-the-art, cutting-edge military like the United States. Mm. But if, on the other hand, what you are primarily concerned about are insurrections, if you're running the Central African Republic, say, or the Côte d'Ivoire, then quite frankly, what you're most concerned about is to have somebody who's a member of your tribe, preferably your brother-in-law.
Well, and this is good, because it also gets the issue of what is the relationship between strategy as domestic politics and strategy when it involves then third parties. Walter McDougall, who happens to be listening in on this conversation, hello, Walter, points out after our discussion about Lee at Gettysburg and Antietam that one of the reasons for invading for the Confederates to try invading the North was they wanted to create circumstances that would encourage British and or French intervention in the war. So in other words, they were hoping to a kind of through this escalation to create a wider escalation. And this gets to a question about making strategy. It's not just a matter of one state makes a strategy with regard to dealing with another, but with the broader international community such as it exists. And I want to ask you, does globalization, since you talk about 600 years or so of history in your book, but do the contemporary issues of globalization with the increasing interconnectedness of the world through economic activity, communications, and exchange, does this create a fundamentally different strategic environment because the whole world is watching than would have pertained in earlier eras? Or is this merely a difference is the game the same, even if the stadium is different?
No, the game isn't the same. Let's just look at that very narrow case, although it's very important, the closeness between Russia and China. Mm-hmm. What that means is that a organization or an alliance or just the United States on its own, but it's really been an alliance system that let us say is trying to deter China in the East or South China Seas, knows that there are sensitivities with what Russia might do. So in other words, let us say that China increases its saber rattling, the United States has to decide whether it is going to focus so much on that, mm-hmm. knowing that there are going to be other powers that might have hostile intent that will use that as an opportunity to cause problems for American interests. Let us say Turkey against Greece or Venezuela against Colombia. So, you know, and that is a degree of interconnectivity that would not have been the case 150 years ago. Mm-hmm. Wasn't the case to the same extent prior to the Cold War.
Right. Well, and a question from Lawrence Husick from out in the audience says that it's often pointed out that strategy emerges from the application of available resources to desired objectives, rather than being crafted a priori. What are the implications of this observation for nations with limited or dwindling resources? Does strategy become more reckless in such cases?
Again, that's very, very interesting. I mean, certainly the classic example that's often cited for that is Japan in 1941 and oil. And indeed, I've got a book which we might come and discuss because it's coming out next year on the strategies of World War II. So we might mm-hmm. come and look at that there. If we're looking at a broader pattern today, The world's taking part in an astonishing experiment, which is the rapid rise in the population. I mean, we're going up about a billion every 15 years. I mean, it's worth bearing in mind that every single day of the COVID epidemic, the world's population has risen. You know, people tend not to be focusing on that. Now, what this will mean, and also another thing you will know, is that food prices are going up in the world. Now, what this will mean is that there are going to be issues of stability. I mean, if you're looking at the Arab Spring, for example, it was increase in food prices that was one of the major triggers in many countries, particularly Egypt. And actually, a very salutary instance about the weakness of the conventional military was the President Mubarak overflying Cairo with his air force, which made absolutely not a ha'porth of difference down on the ground. So I think the gentleman that asked about resources, we are to assume, I imagine, that with resource pressures rising in some countries in the world, many countries in the world, that is likely to lead to more internal violence. Now, that doesn't necessarily need to lead to external conflict. And there you have the tension. It is often the case that if a state doesn't engage in external conflict, we tend to see it as peaceful. But if you're looking at modern India, is, for example, the conflict against the Naxalites, the Marxist insurgents over quite a broad area of East Central India, is that not, in fact, a form of warfare? And of course, because you're using paramilitary police, again, people think, oh, well, this isn't the army. Somehow it's not war. But actually, it doesn't quite seem like that if you're on the ground. Mm-hmm. And again, I think that is something that's interesting. See, in the United States, you have, Americans don't tend to see this, a quite benign history. The American regular armed forces has not needed to spend much of its time over the last 150 years shooting 140 years shooting fellow citizens. All right. But as you will know, that is highly atypical of most states in the world. But it's one of the reasons why I think Americans often find it very difficult to understand war, because they're used to their model of war, mm-hmm. and they're don't really understand that most states, the military is primarily there as the arm of the state. Often the state is there as an arm of the military in some cases. And trying to control that domestic situation, either through the army or through something called the National Guard or something called the Revolutionary Guard or something called the Frontier Police or whatever you're going to call them, is part of a continuum of strategy which is separate to this idea of state versus fight state. So to go back to the 19th century, Jomini or Clausewitz don't actually have to tell you all that much that is terribly helpful if you're looking at the level of violence in many 19th century states, let alone many modern ones.
Well, and related to that, this issue of, for want of a better term, the issue of imperial strategy versus national strategy, one of the things that happens with empires is because they are constantly getting bigger, they fight conflicts either along their expanding periphery or they fight conflicts with rebellious provinces. And so that creates a kind of warfare that is neither completely domestic nor completely foreign. How should we understand the grand strategies of older empires, like say the Byzantine Empire or the various Chinese dynasties? Should we understand, do the strategies of those sorts of empires, which were largely about expansion and pacification, let us say, do they offer us much to understand about contemporary strategy, or is that also with Germany and Clausewitz? Yeah.
As far as contemporary things, I mean, I would have this notion of what I call near America or near Russia or near China. In other words, the United States would regard itself as the key power that ought to take the leading role in the Caribbean, which is why the Cuba issue was so serious to it. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you had a state doing precisely what Cuba was doing in Africa, it was much less consequential, even though the United States is an Atlantic power. Okay. Mm-hmm. And obviously a particular difficulty here is the notion of near China, because obviously there are democracies there, South Korea, Taiwan, and Chinese notion of what it considers its natural area of interest and influence poses enormous problems, and the Chinese are not terribly interested in a rules-based system, whereas the United States has been quite, 1961 was not brilliant in the Bay of Pigs, but since then the Americans have been quite cautious vis-a-vis Cuba. They've, they put pressure on it, but they haven't actually saber-rattled in the terms of threatening war. So partly it's a question of how you adopt a different tone on your imperial peripheries. You're using the notion of empire. I mean, interestingly enough, and you've got Walter listening, and Walter's done a brilliant two-volume history of the United States. I mean, in many senses, the ideology of a liberal, free, democratic empire was the American empire. And although Americans seem to think of themselves, or love to think of themselves at the moment, as living in a failed state, the reality is that America is a singularly successful state to this present day. There is no separatist movement in the United States. Both the main political parties, well, there only are two main political parties, but both those two political parties exist all over the country. There is, a process of change of change between the two major parties that is pretty formulaic. The military does not make a practice of interfering in government, etc., etc., etc. I mean, most major states in the world that are democracies would love to have the problems the United States has. I mean, if you think of India, which is the world's most populous democracy, in a sense, they're suppressing and holding down Kashmir at the moment. They have a high level of corruption in their politics. The United States is an infinitely more successful democracy than India, and Indonesia, which is the next most populous democracy, is scarcely a benign part per politics as far as Sumatra or Borneo or West Irian is concerned. So, and another point, since you're coming up to an election, Americans say to me endlessly, the country has never been so divided. Well, I think they really ought to get their head around their own nation's history for a kickoff. I mean, let's start off with the 1800 election in Virginia, they were so unhappy about the prospect of the Federalists winning that Jefferson was very interested in calling out the state militia. So I think that one has to understand that politics and strategy as an aspect of this is not a question of perfection. It's an attempt to reduce risk by using reason in order to guide thought and understand the possibilities that things will not work out as you want. That is why it is best done between consenting adults in private strategy. It's not really best designed for the public domain, because the public domain, it tends to have extreme dissent advance. So let us say you were to make a very cogent strategic argument. I'm not saying that I agree or disagree with this, because I'm not an American, but let us say you as an American policymaker were to argue that China was a bigger threat to the United States than Iran. Okay? Mm-hmm. You would immediately get a whole host, if you said that in public, a whole host of people would start screaming that Iran is a much bigger threat. Mm-hmm. All right?
But let me jump in here, because you raise a point that's worth exploring in a slightly different way, and that is, you describe the United States as a relatively successful liberal empire, relatively certainly stable, relative both historically and to global history and to its own history. But one of the challenges that face American policymakers is precisely this issue of if there are no immediate pressing threats. Then every strategic move is a choice. In other words, just as you were about to say, right? Do we choose to deal with the China threat or the Iran threat? But if everything is a choice, then also doing nothing would be a choice as well, or doing much less, right? Essentially choosing to withdraw from parts of the world or choosing to avoid confrontations with other states. And yet making strategy as well. How many examples do we have in history of large empires, successful as for however long they've been, choosing a strategy of essentially retiring from the empire business and hoping to be left alone?
Well, that's an excellent question. I'm not suggesting that for a minute for the United States. I mean, the United States, it obviously needs its world role for itself as the great global trading power and with its currency as the global reserve. And also the United States is the support and solace of many endangered democracies around the world, from Israel and Georgia to Taiwan. So it would be a bad thing, and I am a moralist, I do think you can use that term, it would be a bad thing as well as unwise. But all I'm simply saying is that it would be beyond strategic sense to imagine that one was going to fight everybody all of the time. As far as empires choosing, I mean, a good example, I mean, you know, the British have done loads and loads and loads of stupid things, but a good example of an empire that was cautious was, in fact, the British in the New World after 1815. The Americans throw their weight around against people like Mexico. They generally act as, you know, in a very aggressive fashion. And the British make a whole host of adjustments not to get involved in crisis and conflict with the United States, and instead to focus on other areas and other concerns. And in fact, at least one historian has referred to Britain as an appeasing power in the New World, for, you know, so you might not, you know, Americans won't tend to see that. But for example, 1898 is a classic case of appeasement. The world's strongest navy, which is Britain, allows the Americans to kick the shit out of the Spaniards, who really are not doing any threat to anybody. So I think that often one is cautious. And you know, the United States, we used the example of Cuba. The United States has been very cautious there. Cuba is a dictatorship. It has supported hostile and imperialist wars, notably in Angola. From the 1970s through to the beginning of the 90s. And the United States was very cautious. Whether that was right or not's another matter. You can debate that. You're Americans. But all I'm saying is that the Americans have never, whatever the rhetoric might be, have never followed a policy of heedlessly fighting everybody. I mean, the whole nature of the kind of, if you go back to the origins of the FPRI, which was in a sense thinking republicanism, and you would realize that that was associated in the 1950s with the no roll back. In other words, we're not going to go to war to kick the Soviets out of Hungary, etc., etc. It was a process of a balance of being strong and deterrent and only fighting limited wars. Some of those limited wars go well, some of them, Vietnam, do not go well. But that was the nature of that strategy that was followed. And I would say it was a sensible strategy, though I don't myself feel that you want to risk your own troops. I mean, the great thing about Vietnam, which went wrong, I mean, we were discussing what went right. What went wrong was an enormous amount of use of resources, both economic, financial and military, for what was really a limited goal, you know, that so that destabilized America as a whole, and, you know, its foreign policy and military setting. And you could say the same thing happened in both the Iraq war and the Afghanistan war. You could say that one of the problems that is facing us, and I mean the world, but obviously specifically the United States, but also America's allies, which, you know, the British would like to think that's their major role. One of the things that are facing us is the folly of focusing for so long on Iraq and Afghanistan and losing sight of the real danger of China. And I can remember going every single year in the 2000s to give a lecture at the Naval War College in Newport, and the Naval War College, where they had, as you know, a group that were war gaming against China, and they would make it absolutely clear that they were, as far as they were concerned, this, the war was stupid against Iraq, and that they were running in effect a separate, as it were, planning system on the basis that China was most important. That's a classic example. You may or may not agree. Some people listening will be horrified at this, but what in effect you were having was two American foreign policies on offer, and at the military level.
We're back to the issue that if strategy is about choice, that the United States made a series of strategic choices in 2001, 2002, 2003, which took the United States in the direction that it's been in and has been trying to extricate itself from since shortly thereafter, which gets into, there are several variations on this question coming in from the audience. And I want to see if I can try to, in the about 15 minutes we have left, I want to make sure that we can get to as many of them as possible. So there is the question of whether it is necessary for any sort of strategy to include an exit strategy. So in other words, not only a vision of victory, but also just a vision of how one will extricate oneself from a particular action once one begins it. That is one of these questions that I think hangs over all of this. Is, you know, a bunch of smart people can get together and say our goal is, there's a thing about smart people who formed FPRI. They talked about protracted conflict, and therefore sort of figuring out ways to fight over the long term. But if you do that, if you pick an enemy and you pick a conflict, how does one develop a strategy to be prepared to say, well, maybe this conflict turned out to be the wrong conflict, or continuing this conflict no longer serves our purpose? Is how does a state adjust away from a strategy in the absence of an obvious defeat?
Can I answer that? First of all, it's easier for the United States than most countries because you have a democratic government. So what you can do is each time you change your government, you can ditch the wars that weren't successful. You just say they were the previous regime's wars. But being more serious, if you think of a great Philadelphia thinker, the leading American military historian of his generation, Russell Wigley at Temple, great man, nice man, I stayed with him, and really good host as well. You may recall the Russell wrote, he mostly wrote on American military history, but he also actually engaged with the here and now. He wrote a couple of articles disagreeing with the Powell Doctrine. Powell had produced these ideas saying the American military should only go to war under the following circumstances, which included a clear exit strategy. And Wigley said, no, this is totally wrong. That might be what the generals want, but there actually may be the need to commit people to a war that isn't an easy one and that doesn't necessarily have a clear exit strategy. All right. Classic example is a counter-terrorist war or counter-insurgency war. So, for example, if you want a British example, and again, just to irritate some of your listeners, the British in Northern Ireland, they were there on a counter-terrorist war, which was not easy to win, and where soldiers don't like being shot in the back by terrorists, even if they're being paid by Americans, these terrorists that are, that is. But the fact of the matter was that it was up to the government to decide that they wanted to stand firm against terrorists, not up to the military to decide that they wanted to say, we'll have this many years or this many troops lost, and then we want to change the situation. So that is a very quick point. Yeah, you're right. You do need to have the maturity to accept that you don't always get it right, and that's not easy. And partly it also, let's be clear about this, partly it is made harder when you have a disjuncture socially between the military and the rest of society. And as you will know, if you socialize with military figures in the United States or Britain, they will often complain that there are fewer members of Congress or fewer members of Parliament that have served in the military, etc., etc., etc. I remember I was once West Point visiting professor, and the superintendent took me to dinner, and there were just the two of us sitting there. And I said, so I felt I could ask him the question, do you mind that about a third of the people coming through West Point don't then go into the military? And he said, no, we don't mind at all. We actually want a lot of our people to go out as and be pro-military, but in a different aspect of national life. But the fact of the matter is, it is difficult at the present moment, just as, if you want another example, you see the same thing for the terrible problems the American police are under. You know, I'm not in any way excusing individual policemen that do the wrong thing, that no more than I would in Britain or any other country. But the fact of the matter is, the bulk of the public have no idea of the difficulty of policing a city in which a lot of individuals are armed, and a lot of them are, shall we say, high on drugs, or if you were doing it in Karachi, say, high on ideology. These are difficult tasks. So part of the problem is, who is going to end the war? You need to actually have the ability politically to say, this is not working. We owe it to our forces to rethink this. And people aren't always willing to do that.
Well, and that's where we're back to the issue of politics. But we're also back to the issue of what does it mean to think about these things and plan? And I know that you've already made clear that you're not a big fan of theorizing for theorists' sake, but several of our listeners have asked about the issue of grand strategy. In other words, what does it mean for a state to have a grand strategy? And I would add, based on what you just brought up, is how should states conceive of having a strategy if they also know that they have to deal with difficult political questions, or that if whatever they start, they will have a hard time ending?
Okay, could I try and answer that? Again, sure. A brilliant American concept here. It was Americans that went with the idea, they developed the idea of what was called strategic culture. Mm-hmm. Strategic culture was developed, it was an American called Johnson that developed it, essentially in order to write initially about China in the 1970s, because obviously you couldn't believe a word that was coming out of the Chinese government. So to try and work out what were the structural factors taking China in a particular direction. And the notion of strategic culture is essentially that each state will have, as a result of its environment, but both physical and human, but also as a result of its cultural character and historical, geopolitical and other factors, a set of strategic goals. And that is the key element. Mm-hmm. And that, in a sense, you might vary the means by which you try and pursue these goals, but you need to think in terms of these strategic cultures. Now, I've written about that. I wrote a book on War, the Cultural Turn, which was about strategic culture. And yes and no. It's a very valuable concept. I like it. I've used it a lot. But also, it's a loose concept, because the reality is that in those countries that have public politics, you might have no real capacity to agree. So let us say you were taking France today. The Front National, Marine Le Pen's crew, have a different, to put it mildly, strategic culture to the strategic culture you will get from Melanchthon and the left. All right. Again, Germany, you're a German expert, you will know that alongside those who in Germany are pro-NATO, pro-West, there are others who at best are neutralists and at worst closer alignment, or what we might call almost appeasement of Russia. And, you know, both of those elements are there. So strategic culture is valuable, just as grand strategy, which is a variant on the idea of strategic culture. Grand strategy tends to be an American phrase. Very rarely elsewhere in the world do you find the phrase grand strategy used. So for your listeners, it's more usually the phrase is just strategy. But Graham's strategy assumes that there is a clear set of goals. But, you know, I hope to be on talking about American policy during World War II. So let's remember that in both World War II, but even after World War II, who lost China question, there were those people that argued the United States should put a focus on East Asia. And there were those people, Philadelphia being a classic center of this view, who were more Atlanticists. And the two of them did not get on, I think it's fair to say. And then you can go right the way back. If you look at American congressional votes, if you look at the congressional votes in 1812 over war with Britain, 1846 over war with Mexico, 1917 over war with Germany, there was considerable dissent in each case. There were, you know, we're not talking about troublemakers on the extremes. We're talking about mainstream politicians who thought the wrong thing was being done and were willing to argue their case very cogently in Congress. So I think even in a state where, you know, you don't in the United States have extreme parties of left and right, but even in the United States context, there's wide variations of views as to what strategy should be. And once you move to political systems which have parties that are extreme left and extreme right, it becomes very difficult. So let me give you an instance. In 2014 in Britain, there was a referendum in Scotland as to whether there should be independence for Scotland. Incidentally, they didn't ask the English to vote. I think they would all have voted for independence for Scotland, but that was leave that to one side. The Scottish National Party is still the leading party in Scotland and would still like another referendum. Now, the Scottish National Party has talked very actively about closing the nuclear base at Faslane, which is probably the most important individual base in Britain from NATO purposes. From their point of view, the Scottish National Party's point of view, I have no brief for the SNP, but from their point of view, that is an acceptable paradigm in their view of their strategic culture. It does, the fact that it doesn't really all mix up with any of the other British political parties is not their problem as they see it.
Well, unfortunately, we are almost out of time, but I've liked where this is going, because it is helping us to tie this all back up, and that is that if we think about the making of strategy, the making of these choices, that whether you're talking about a Republican form of government or even if you're just talking about the elite within an authoritarian regime, there are going to be alternatives, and you have to make choices and you have to make priorities, and yet once you have made your choice. Even if you make the choice based on a compromise, like the debate over war with Mexico, right? Whether one was in favor or against it, by 1846, the United States was at war with Mexico. Then you have this problem of making further adjustments. And how, you know, one would hope, I suppose, that the state in question would have robust enough institutions, either public or purely internal institutions, that would allow the working out of differences of opinion. And I guess what we're seeing right now in Great Britain today, dealing with Brexit, in the United States as it comes up with its election, in India, whichever places you want to think about, we're still wrestling with this idea of, unfortunately, with strategy, you don't just get to make one decision and that's your decision forever. Is the old joke about in the 1960s, Tom Lehrer sang a song about the Germans saying, you know, once all the Germans were wartime, warlike and mean, but that wouldn't happen again. We taught them a lesson in 1918, and they've hardly even bothered us since then. Strategy is about thinking long-term. Strategy is about being flexible enough to recognize when one has to adjust.
Yeah, and can I give you a good example?
And let me give you, we have I want to give you 30 seconds for a final thought, Jeremy Black. Go ahead.
Right. Three things. 1848, the Americans did not hold on to most of their gains in Mexico. Very sensible. Two, I'd like to come back to talk to you about World War II and the strategy there. But the third point, which is simply this. you shouldn't assume perfection in politics, strategy being an aspect of politics. And one of the great problems is too many people wish to assume that they can have a perfect outcome. That is naive, foolish, and never justified by history.
Very good. Very, very good place to end this conversation, which we managed to hit on many of the themes in a very, very detailed and useful book I recommend, Military Strategy, Global History by Jeremy Black. Jeremy Black, thank you so much for joining us today.
FPRI, to everybody in Philadelphia.
Thank you, Jeremy. And FPRI would like to thank all of our sponsors and partners for their generous support for this program and all of you for joining us on Zoom. I'm sorry if we didn't get to everyone's questions, but I hope that we got to enough of those questions that you found the conversation to be worthwhile. We encourage you, if you are not already a member or partner of FPRI and you enjoyed this conversation or would like to see more such conversations, that you would consider becoming a member or partner of FPRI, because today's conversation is just the beginning. The world goes on and we will always be here to discuss it at FPRI. To keep up with future episodes of People, Politics, and Prose and other events at FPRI, please visit our website, fpri.org, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. You can follow the host of this program on Twitter, at Ronald Granieri. But until next time, for all of us at FPRI, I'm Ron Granieri. Thanks for joining us.